Thank you so much for the opportunity. And I would like to congratulate the faculty and the organizers of this program for giving me this opportunity. I would like to first talk about what is so unique about Bangalore as a state, as a city which attracts the talent for startups. How all this happened? It happened in early 70s when Electronic City was established by the government. And interestingly, Electronic City started well before there was internet and well before we became familiar with the software. It was an amazing thought by the government, extremely well implemented, covering over 800 acres of land with some of the brightest minds on the planet working. And Electronic City led to the startup innovation activities and many, many billion dollar enterprises. And as you drive from Bangalore City towards Electronic City, I call this road as the knowledge corridor. It is a knowledge corridor because on the way to Electronic City, you find many, many buildings harboring many, many startups, many, many mature companies. Then after Electronic City, you come across Biocon, which is considered as one of the world's top biotechnology companies and its cluster of activities around that area. So we have Electronic City, then we have Biotech City around Kiran's Biocon. Then you drive further down, you have Narayan Hrudayalaya Health City, which is covering about 30 acres of land with 5 hospitals, with thousands of patients coming from across the world seeking medical care. So together, they form a very formidable combination of knowledge-based cluster of activities which can perhaps change the future of the world. How all these things happened in Bangalore? It happened mainly because of the foresight of our government and the policymakers and entrepreneurs this state has given birth to. We have one of the largest number of engineering colleges in the country. And these engineering colleges produce thousands of young engineers, brightest engineers. They are the ones who are powering some of the top software companies, biotech companies across the world. Then Karnataka state boasts of having the largest number of medical colleges in the country. So we produce some of the brightest doctors who are today stars of healthcare delivery in US, Europe, and rest of the world. We have one of the largest number of nursing and paramedical institutions. With this, Karnataka state and Bangalore especially has emerged as a city for caring, city for innovation, and city which can design the future of the world. And then we have Indian Institute of Sciences, National Law School, and many, many such institutions, which makes it extremely, extremely attractive. Why startup? We need startups because startups are generally started by young people who do not know what is not possible. In their mind, everything is possible. And that is the state of mind which changes the world. I'm so happy to know that Indian Institute, the IIM Bangalore is now thinking about a large innovation cell for startups in healthcare. Why it is important to have startups in healthcare? Because there is a serious problem in delivering healthcare. You may not be aware that global healthcare and wellness industry is an $8.2 trillion industry. It is the largest industry in the world. For your knowledge, the food industry, agro industry is only $8 trillion. We spend more on being, to maintaining our well-being than sustaining by eating food. Everyone thinks automobile industry is a big industry. It's hardly 2 trillion. IT is 3.4 trillion. It's a huge industry. But the tragedy is, after spending $8.2 trillion, less than 20% of the world's population has access to tertiary healthcare, which is desperately required. Now, if tomorrow, if all the policymakers of the world decide it is unacceptable, let at least half the world's population have access to decent healthcare, we need $16 trillion, which doesn't exist in this world. Now, that means, are you going to resign to the fact that you're going to let 70 to 80% of the world's population to suffer and die? That is not acceptable. Now, who is going to change? Only the startups can change. You will change by changing the way healthcare is delivered. Let's look at three important things in delivering healthcare. Healthcare has to become safe for the patients. Today, healthcare delivery is not safe for the patients. In US, medical error, not negligence, medical error is the third leading cause of death in US. It is much more than road traffic accident or breast cancer. We want healthcare to be safer for the patient. We want hospitals to become safer. Only startups can do it. We want healthcare to be affordable by reducing the cost. For that, we need to change the way healthcare is delivered. You can do it. And we want healthcare to access everyone, whether they are living in the city or in villages. It is possible. It is possible with telemedicine becoming a reality in the country. It is possible. Thanks to COVID, a lot of good things also have happened in the country. Technological breakthroughs in healthcare, which would have otherwise taken 5 to 10 years for the government to legislate and the people to accept. Instead of 5 years, people accepted in 5 weeks. And today, half my patients see me sitting in their bedroom in remote locations of the country. All this transformation to happen, we need one thing. If you are asked as a young entrepreneur, if you want to change the way healthcare is delivered, if you are going to make healthcare safer for the patients, affordable to the patients, accessible to the patients, and you are asked to do only one thing, what you will do? What you should do is to remove the pen and paper from the hands of doctors, nurses, and medical technicians and give them a smart digital tool to deliver healthcare. And that will take care of the rest. Believe me, once we have software which is guiding all the medical care, healthcare will dramatically undergo change. I have no doubt that smart software will make smarter diagnosis than doctors in the next 3 to 5 years. In 5 to 7 years, it will become legally mandatory for every doctor to get the second opinion from the software before starting the treatment. This is going to happen. No one can stop it. Now, how will it happen? It will happen if all of you believe that it is going to happen, and we are the people, we are the agents who are going to make it happen. And that is your responsibility. Now, look at a regular house. We started off with glucometer to check the blood sugar in houses where there is a diabetic. Today, in every house, there is a digital thermometer. Most houses today, thanks to COVID, has a pulse oximeter, which can give the knowledge about how your lung is functioning, what is your heart rate is, and you have a BP apparatus, you have a glucometer, you have a weighing machine. It is a matter of time before your house will be filled with gadgets. I wear a watch. And this watch gives me, any time I feel I'm missing a beat, I have to just touch the button and it gives my ECG. And I'm worried whether my I'm a little bit short of breath. Is it COVID? Because from morning till evening, I'm surrounded by patients. All I need to do is to touch the button and it will reassure me by saying that my oxygen saturation is okay. Now, it is a matter of time before every watch in the world will have all these tools. Then when that happens, it is a matter of time before watch will give the diagnosis and the doctors have to reinforce the diagnosis and guide the patient in caregiving process. Eventually, we will reach a stage wherein patient is going to take care of himself and the doctors are only going to guide them. I just want to explain to you that if you think that healthcare has done a fantastic job so far, I agree you are right, but is there something more needs to be done? Believe me, we have only touched the tip of the iceberg. Now, if you want healthcare to become accessible, affordable to everyone, you need to come up with new tools. And that will only happen if you all start collaborating with the hospitals. And in your venture to start something new, do not be obsessed in collecting huge amount of money to start off. Because in my experience, if you have lots of money, your brain stops working. Need to be very, very frugal from the very beginning. And the most important advice I have for all of you is that I just want to ask the coordinator, how many minutes I have?
Another 10 minutes.
Okay. So the most important quality of your startup being successful is the hard work. If you are going to enter the startup world and if you are looking for a work-life balance, you forget it. You're not going to reach anywhere. At this stage, I work for 12 to 16 hours every day. And if you do not have that eccentricity, do not get into this area. Work-life balance is people who want to get into that sphere. Let them not, God didn't create everyone alike. Lot of people value work-life balance. What work-life balance a young soldier has on Siachen Glacier? So essentially, these are the paths, these are the choices you all make. And once you make a choice, do not compromise. And never get disheartened when you fail. Failure is part of life. And if you ask me, what are the new things what I need in healthcare? I need drones. I need drones because city like Bangalore, why do we need the 50 blood banks? We just need two or three blood banks. All we need is a blood bank which is surrounded by drones, and every hospital, they have to just send a message to the blood bank and the drone can fly the blood in Bangalore city in less than 15 minutes. Why do you need so many laboratories checking the blood and various tests? We need few labs and rest can be collection centers. So and we need robot. And why do we need robot? In our one hospital in Bangalore, where we have 300 critical care beds, at any given time, there are at least 50 young girls running around taking one syringe of blood from the bedside to the blood gas machine. They don't do any intelligent work. They just courier, carry the blood samples from a syringe. I need a drone which is designed like a toy. Sorry, I need a robot which is designed like a toy, which can navigate itself in the ICU, come out of the ICU, go to the blood gas machine, and somebody will do the blood gas report, and the robot will go back. And I want it to be available for 50,000 rupees. Then I will buy few thousand of these drones. But important thing is do not try to create something which is costing 10 lakh, 20 lakh rupees. That's not what I want. This robot can stop functioning I can have 10 the extra drones to supplement, but I want the job to be done by the machine. Is it because I'm trying to save money? No, I cannot have people working near the patient. With all these infectious diseases coming, every person entering the ICU is risking himself or risking herself or risking others if they are carriers. We want in a hospital only doctors, nurses, and medical technicians to work. All the rest should work from home online. So I need all these gadgets. Now I'll go completely away from my industry. I want you all to design a fire sensor which can detect fire when it happens. At any given time, when I have 300 patients in the ICU, at least 200 of them are dependent on the life-saving machines like ventilator, ECMO, balloon pump, all kinds of supports. If there is a fire, how do I evacuate them? Evacuation in a specialty hospital is not an option. Now, I did a lot of study on fire sensors, come up with a new technology, and I was horrified to know the fire sensor in India, US, Europe, what we have so-called the which we see in every room on top of the roof, that was invented in 1892. Since then, there has been no innovation in detecting fire when it happens. That is stupid. When the fire happens, it emits light. There are light sensors. It emits heat. It changes the wave of the airflow in the room. There are 10 different sensors you guys can come up with. A fire sensor, that is smoke detector. I'm sorry, it's not a fire, it's a smoke detector. Smoke detector in an air conditioning room will never detect smoke until the whole room is filled with smoke. Because air conditioning room, all the smoke is sucked out by the air conditioning system. So why this hasn't happened? This hasn't happened because the end users like us, we haven't got an opportunity to discuss and spend time with the people who can make things happen. So it is a phenomenal opportunity you all have. There are so many big hospitals, and I'll take the personal responsibility of bringing all those hospitals to invest on your company or guide you. But more than the investing, what you need is a customer. When you come up with a product, you need somebody to use the product and give the feedback and make it like a product which has a market value. And all those things, with our contacts, we can make it happen. Once again, I'm so happy that y'all are decided to walk in this path. Good luck and God bless. And I would like to congratulate the entire team of IIM Bangalore for making this happen. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot for this talk and the fact that you highlighted the various innovations that are required in the healthcare sector, and at the same time highlighting that these innovations should be affordable too. We'll now begin our panel discussion on demystifying failures in the healthcare startup. The audience can post your questions to the panelists in the Q&A section. Today's panel includes Dr. Devi Prasad Shetty. We also have Dr. Vishal Rao, who is the Regional Director of Head Neck Surgical Oncology and Robotic Surgery at HCG. He's a TEDx speaker and the inventor of the OM voice prosthesis at $1, a speaking device for throat cancer patients. He has more than 18 patents filed for his innovations on medical devices, drugs, techniques, and theory. He has won several awards for his innovation. Next, we have Mr. Kiran Anandam Pillai. He's the CEO and founder of Drishti. He's a core volunteer for healthcare at iSpirit and also a technology advisor at National Health Authority on the National Digital Health Mission and Ayushman Bharat. He believes that setting up the right technology building blocks can help India leapfrog in how healthcare is being delivered. We also have Mr. Rajesh Nair. He is a Geneva-based advisor to UN, NGOs, and other multilateral agencies on digital innovation and financing. Since 2010, Rajesh has been working with Global Fund for AIDS, TB, and malaria, and later with WHO, UNAIDS, and Red Cross, advising them on scaling digital innovation, AI for good, and making them sustainable for projects mostly in Africa and Asia. The session will be moderated by Dr. Prashant, who's a consultant and head of department of ENT at BGS Hospital. He's passionate about creating a whole ecosystem for healthcare innovations and entrepreneurs to ensure that the success rate of healthcare products improves and they can go to market at a faster pace. He's known as the surgeon of strategy. Over to you, Dr. Prashant.
Thank you, Aarti. Can the host make the videos on? Because it's kind of difficult for the panelists to see each other.
Yeah, I think that's not possible. There seems to be a technical glitch on that.
No. Dr. Devishetty, can you enable us the host? Can you give us the host? You just right-click on us, actually, I think, or you can make everybody co-host. Yeah, I think I can make, 1 second, Prashant, I'm making you co-host. Okay, I think right now it is not there. I think we have to make the host only. Only host can.
Okay, no problem. We can just.
They haven't got it. 1 second, give me a minute, let me see.
Yeah, it's okay. Prashant, can I make you a host?
Sure. Can I? Okay. How do I turn on the video of everyone else?
No, sir. Everybody's videos is off only. Only your video is visible.
Yeah, you are seen by everybody. You can't see others. Yeah.
Okay. Welcome to the panel discussion. So today's panel discussion will be on demystifying failures in healthcare startups. And it will be a round robin question answer thing. So each question will be directed to individual panelists. So to start off, Dr. Devishetty sir, this is for you. So according to you, what is the primary factor which contributes to the failure of the startups, especially in healthcare? Because the healthcare startups, the success rate is only 1%, whereas other startups have 10% success rate. And what is your mantra or advice for these startups to become successful?
See, when you are not from the healthcare industry, as an outsider, it is very difficult for you to imagine what the requirement is and what is the complexity. So if the startup has any plan for healthcare, the most important thing is they should tie up with a doctor or a hospital. Preferably a large hospital. The reason why large hospital is, eventually they not only advise and guide, they also become buyers of the product when it comes out. So essentially by doing it, you have created the market well before your product is ready. That will only happen if the hospital or the doctor has a skin in the game. So somehow you have to convince the doctor and the hospital. If possible, invest a small amount of money. However small, it is not the quantum of money which has the value. It is the advice they give, and eventually by them becoming the first customer, you already have a customer before the product is ready. And unless this you are not able to get before you start your work, unless you're really, really sure about the compelling reason why hospitals will buy your product, believe me, no matter what you do, you will not be able to sell. I'll give a simple example. Supposing you came with an amazing tool for diabetic care, and you expect this to be a breakthrough product. Now, for your information, unlike the regular consumer industry, the maximum number of clients you can get for your software is 600. Because there are only 600 diabetologists in the country. And that tool is of no use for others. Now, tying up with the diabetologist well in advance will give you the insight that the best scenario is for my software, I can only get 600 or maybe 1,000 the people buyers. Then how do I do the logistics and the costing and the viability? So that knowledge itself is important. Now, it is still worthwhile if the hospital says, you do this and I will pay you for the software enough to justify your effort and the expense. But then there is a big market outside India. Once you saturate Indian market, the value you will get outside India is 10 times more. Sadly enough, in India, no hospital values software. They feel that we can also do it. They do not until they start getting into it, they don't understand. So the most important advice I have for all the startups is that find a partner, a hospital, preferably a large group or at least a large hospital or a dynamic doctor who has the cloud and somehow get them to invest a small amount of money in your startup. Then you're likely to win.
Noted, sir. And what is your mantra for these to success is ensuring that they tie up with the hospitals or with someone who has the cloud to ensure that they are successful. Now, this question is open for the other panelists to come in and give their viewpoints.
Yeah. So, can I go, Prashant?
Yes, yes.
What we do at the UN Health Innovation Exchange in Geneva, first of all, thank you for this privilege. It is fantastic to be on this stellar panel. Can you hear me clearly, Prashant?
Yes, it's very fantastic. Clear.
Okay, so essentially, we work in Geneva. We set up the Health Innovation Exchange to basically help startups work with essentially policymakers and countries. So we work almost with 150 governments, ministries of health, and institutions. Now, essentially, I think your question is about policymaking and how what are the challenges they have in terms of policy, right, Prashant? Hello?
You're on mute, Prashant.
Prashant, you're on mute.
Oh, sorry. The we're still on the first question as to what do you think are the issues which the startups fail, and what do you think is the startup mantra for them for the success?
Yeah, I think one issue that we definitely most startups face is with regulations and policy making, because you know when it comes to startups, essentially. When you say digital health, for example, there are many, many things that they do within digital health, whether it's buying medicines online or AI or data privacy issues, robotics, etc. So there is no one regulator who can actually help the startup. So the startups are generally a bit lost on who to go to this to you know get this kind of permissions. And what we have seen is typically, and we work with a startup, for example, on AI, where they were using AI for essentially going with detecting TB using image recognition using AI. Now, the startup came to us and said, we are thinking of setting up operations in two East European countries and in one South Asian country. Now, what we have seen is, and this is based on actual experience, this startup took about 14 months to set up shop in two East European countries. The same startup is almost, now it's 4 years, and they're still going around in circles in one of our neighboring countries. I don't want to name the country, but these are the kind of challenges typically startups face. And obviously, they need a lot of help from policymakers. Obviously, like Dr. Shetty said, doctors need to guide them. But when it comes to patenting, policymaking, connecting them to government, We at the UN, we are trying to take an active role in this. So I'll stop there, Prashant. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Vishal, your viewpoints, if you have any.
Thanks, Prashant. I think what Dr. Shetty alluded to was something so simple, so beautiful. And I think that's something that we need to reiterate here. Take, for example, the stethoscope. I mean, I'm coming back to the question that you asked about why they fail. Stethoscope was such a simple example of something that was invented in 1800 by Linac. But the most popular one, which we all remember in our medical school, is the Littmann stethoscope. The Littmann stethoscope was the classic combination of the Harvard professor called Littmann, who actually, David Littmann, who actually invented it in his own technique, and 3M joining hands with him to expand it. And that is the kind of collaboration, I think, what Dr. Shetty was alluding to, and we all should connect, that this is the time in ecosystem where we jointly do it. It is not that, because a lot of the times engineers or non-health experts come to us and say, we had this idea because we read something, but it has no practical implication. That is so important that when you sit inside a healthcare system and co-invent with a doctor, you understand the nitty-gritties of it. And sir spoke about funding, but I would say even the originality of the idea, defining the problem, is so crucial here. The definition of the problem, when you build your entire company, your projection, plan, marketing is built around an idea. What is the question that comes up here is most relevant. And refining that question can only happen with strategic medical partnership. And I'm sure that the NSR cell here is actually bringing in, like, you as a doctor here are playing this role here to build this ecosystem so that doctors and engineers, non-health experts come together to define questions better and program that and succeed better.
Thank you. Mr. Kiran, you have any inputs from your end on this question?
Actually, Kiran dropped out because of the network. I think he's joining back.
No, I'm just back, but please continue, Prashant. Nothing specific to add. I think Dr. Devi Shetty and the others have actually eloquently phrased what it takes.
Thank you. Now, going to the next question. This is for you, Mr. Rajesh. So what are the hurdles which are faced by the startup in digital health space, and how can the policy makers help them?
Understood. So essentially, from a policy making is a pretty vast subject when it comes to digital health. And when it comes to policy making, it can get as complex as you want to make it complex, but I'll try to keep it simple. So when we work with all these startups right from Silicon Valley to Malawi, the challenges are way different in each country. And it's very difficult to actually say that there is one set of problems across policymaking. But we can draw some conclusions, but it is always different because in many places, sometimes the government itself is going away in a month or two. There are banana republics that we're dealing with and things like that. So so I will talk about solutions here because I talked a bit about the challenges in policy. So what last year the EU did was to set up the Allied Startup for Health, which is an organization essentially of policymakers, the startups and others who are, I would call it a lobby group, but essentially a group of people who are trying to tell the governments and the policymakers on how well they can keep changing the policy so that the startups can, you know, quickly go to market. To give you an example, in Switzerland, I was working with a company on drones, in which Dr. Shetty was mentioning. Within a year, they came up with a whole map of how, what are the routes a drone can fly with, you know, blood supplies. They mapped the entire thing. And today, Europe will almost have a map of where a drone can fly in the next 1 or 2 years. If you compare that to where many of the South Asian countries or the other countries are, we are still way behind when it comes to that. As I said, it's not that we're not doing anything. So we at the Health Innovation Exchange, we are working with a few of the government agencies. And what we are trying to set up is what we call the Health Technology Assessment Alliance. And now what HTA is, obviously you might know, it's a WHO protocol, which is health technology assessment. What we want to bring an alliance of companies and countries, sorry, and about 40 countries have expressed interest to come together and form this alliance. And obviously we are still looking for partners, and it'd be fantastic to have your esteemed organization also participating at a later stage, but we can discuss that later. So this is one issue. Number two, obviously is skill sets in health, digital health. So I think Dr. Shetty is a big proponent of this. He's been not so much digital health, but he's been talking about the whole medical profession and the kind of skill sets needed. And in fact, one of his videos is viral in Geneva and New York, all over the place. So essentially, I think the same thing is needed in digital health. To give you an example, at the Global Fund, we used to give about $4 billion every year in terms of grants to different countries for HIV, TB, and malaria. Of this $4 billion, about $500 million is for health system strengthening, setting up supply chains, et cetera. And from my experience, most countries in Africa, or a large number of countries in Africa, the Ministry of Health don't even know how to write an RFP or a request for proposal to set up an IT system. So this is an extremely challenging situation where we want to digitize health, but we don't have the digital skill sets in the country. And lastly, I'll leave you with one thought. We talk so much about telemedicine, et cetera, but today we only have about 40% of the world's population actually having high-speed internet to use these technologies. So as innovators, what we need to think is, how can we bridge this digital divide? Obviously there are new technologies like Starlink coming up. How can we adopt this and not make it an exclusive club again? So I will stop there, Prashant, and thank you.
Thank you, Rajesh. Dr. Shetty, your thoughts on how the policy makers can help in the startup ecosystem, building up and ensuring that the policies are streamlined?
I'll give you one example, how the new digital initiative by the government, which can transform the healthcare, or it can stifle the healthcare innovation. It is very, very, I was vaguely involved with some of the discussions. In US, HEPA is very, very important for protecting the patient data. It is important even in India. But the way HEPA is implemented in US, if Indian government insists that we want the same standard like in US, there is no startup scenario at all in healthcare, because the cost of protecting the data with multiple layers of security will make it so complex and so expensive that you simply cannot have any patient data with you. So I am a very strong proponent of patient data privacy. But patient data cannot be more precious than patient's life. So we need to draw a balance between where we are in India, what is the paying capacity of our patients, and if we saddle these software tools, which are likely to come in the near future, with so many regulatory hurdles that you have to comply with all those issues, then it will become unaffordable. And if a solution is not affordable, it is not a solution. So my suggestion to everyone, especially the regulatory framework when we are creating, safety, privacy issue are very, very important. But do not look at what is happening in US. There are many other better models we can look at from Europe and rest of the world. But whatever innovation you are coming up with, let's not stifle it with the putting so many hurdles. A artist can create a phenomenal product, provided they have a very, very open canvas to create. Once you give them 100 different hurdles which he has to comply with, the real creativity dies.
True, sir. That's very, very true. Mr. Kiran, do you want to come in on this question?
Sure. Yeah, I think, definitely in an emerging area, and especially like digital health, as Dr. Devi Shetty was saying, the two things that I have definitely seen from a government perspective, where the government is trying to support startups. For example, at the National Health Authority, they launched a program called the Market Access Program, which was a way by which they could select startups which had certain innovations that could be very useful to the hospital sectors, and specifically the network of hospitals under Ayushman Bharat. And they're looking at ways and means by which this can actually be promoted to that base, so that kind of there is a ability for, because one of the most challenging things in general for the healthcare ecosystem is actually public procurement, or making through to getting their solutions become part of the public procurement space. So this is one example where, for example, I have seen the government actually step out to try to help the ecosystem or the startups kind of come forward. The other, of course, is what I'm currently involved with, and which is the National Digital Health Mission. And the idea is, while much of the innovation that we know in the future is going to come from technology itself, it's only going to happen if we are all able to agree on and work together on a common set of standards and a set of interfaces that allows this data that today is actually highly fragmented and unstructured to actually kind of come together in the context of patient and patient care. So the National Digital Health Mission is really that initiative that's kind of trying to say, okay, how do we get health data that's currently, present in all of these various hospitals and labs in various formats, to actually work together in the interest of the patients, but also in the interest of actually improving how healthcare, or leapfrogging how healthcare is delivered. And it uses a philosophy which we call as, public goods and private innovation. So, the role of the government is to only provide a few very select digital public goods. And, the parallels we draw typically are with, what we have seen as an experience with how Aadhaar provided a digital public good for identity and authentication, how UPI provided a digital public good for financial transaction to happen. So the National Digital Health Mission is kind of built or designed on the same principle. And I really think that this will enable many startups to actually find new opportunities as we go forward. And so in many ways, again, in this policy, government is playing. But yes, I do agree with Dr. Shetty that, there is a balance that it's a very nascent, very young, early stage, and there needs to be a balance that has to be struck, especially, how far do you lean on the privacy side? What do you allow and what do you allow? And if you go too far, it is likely to also kill innovation. So, policymakers do have to be extremely stringent and look at what's the line that actually enables an ecosystem versus actually can probably stifle an ecosystem.
Prashant, I have one more suggestion.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Yeah, my request to the government is to create a consortium of all the Asian and African countries where we recognize each other country's innovative products in healthcare. Healthcare is a regulated industry. Today, an Indian startup comes up with a very, very advanced ECG machine with analytics. Now, he has to get the clearance from every country in Africa, every country in Asia and Latin America. And whatever product we do, we should not really look at getting US FDA, because US FDA is designed in a manner that it will not be possible for our startups to get it, at least in the initial half of our existence. So our biggest market is Asia, Africa, and Latin America. If India takes a lead, creating a consortium of all these countries together, saying that we will recognize your innovative product provided you recognize our innovative product. Then when an Indian startup creates a ECG machine or a fancy ventilator, automatically they have recognition across the real world, which is nearly 70% of the world's population. And that can, with the current position our government holds in the world scenario, and the current government's position as projected by all the other countries, we are in a position to drive that, and our government can easily do it. That's a clout our government enjoys. I think that is something we should all try to convince the policymakers to make it happen.
Definitely, sir. I think Rajesh has something to say in this regard.
Yeah, I think I completely agree with Dr. Shetty on this, because if we try to go into the Western world, it's going to be a very long haul for our startups. But we are actively working with ICMR and a few other organizations to do a south-to-south collaboration, like Dr. Shetty mentioned. Happy to talk about this later with the HIEX and things like that. But thank you very much. That's a good point.
Dr. Vishal, since you are an innovator, your key inputs on how you faced the issues of policy?
Thanks, Prashant. Again, to add to what Dr. Shetty said and Kiran said, I think I would like to just add 2 points here. There are two important interventions. I think the one thing that we lack is policy crosstalk between policies. So just to give you an example, I keep telling my friends who have been working in the area of electronic medical records, EMRs, that the biggest problem in digital transformation is the crosstalk between the Drugs and Cosmetic Act and the ITBT Act. Unless they both don't talk to each other and make a common connect, something as simple as an e-prescription will not be legal. So there has to be a crosstalk between policies. This is very, very important. Two important policies, either in the health and in the non-health domains, crosstalk with each other. If blockchain has to succeed, if AI has to succeed, there has to be a crosstalk. And I'm sure that Government of India is already pondering on these lines. And the second important thing is policies regarding funding. I think today's funding is going to be one single bottleneck that we're going to face, where we're going to get, you know, the startups will need oxygen to survive. They will not be able to survive. Now, the ecosystem, again, definitely is slowly changing. I'm sure BIRAC is one such example that has shown about fast tracking, but we need 10 such things to happen in this ecosystem. Because if you see the current status of innovations and the current status of funding, by the time the researchers or innovators try to apply to a grant, it is almost 6 months to 1 year. And by that time, that startup would have perished and the idea would have perished. So fast tracking ecosystem, and I simply give the example of Formula One racing. If you can get a pit stop in 1 second, like the Bura racetrack that got it in 1.08 seconds, you should be able to save a life before that, and you should be able to save a startup before that. So what if ecosystems like what Dr. Shetty said can come together to quickly fund startups, wherein you do it in days and hours, not in months and years, that the startup gets fatigued by writing grants over grants, and on the other side you have venture capitalists who are vulture capitalists. So it doesn't kind of match the whole ecosystem for innovations.
Very true, sir. Thank you for your inputs. And that's something which we are trying to do in NSRSL. We are trying to create the whole ecosystem for medical startups and healthcare startups such that they are faster in understanding how to enter the market and also get the correct access to the hospitals and to the funds. Moving on to Mr. Kiran.
Sorry, one more point I want to add to what Dr. Shetty said. See, what he said is so relevant and important. It's such an important thing about how to create such an ecosystem. Now here, if you see, for example, I got to know through one of the regulatory authorities when I was in one of the meetings of the drug controller, that if you get regulatory clearance in India, you actually have complete regulatory clearance to enter 40 countries of this world. I can share that list. I think every startup, rather than looking at targeting USA and Europe, should actually start focusing on these 40 countries. You've opened the market. Now that itself is a great ecosystem, because already India has got regulatory approvals to enter into these 40 countries. Now I think that's a very big market. They can actually open up and thrive there.
Very true, sir. Thank you for those. Actually, those are something which you have been working on, and you are trying to establish your product to be accessible there. That's something which you have done a very tremendous job in. And now going to Mr. Kiran, since you are working on the government side's health stack and iSpread, how do you think the healthcare data can be democratized, and how it can help in transformation towards a digital front?
Thanks, Prashant. And I think I'll just give a short background. I think many of the attendees may have heard of the National Digital Health Mission that was officially launched by the Prime Minister on August 15 this year with the talk of the Health ID. But, you know, Health ID itself is just one of these building blocks that's actually been visualized on the overall digital infrastructure. Now, the core problem in many ways that this phase or the initial phase of the National Digital Health Mission is trying to solve is the idea of unlocking personal data and enabling personal data to move from providers like hospitals or diagnostic labs to patients and other care providers with the consent of the patient, you know. And the way the architecture works is that, you know, today much of, while, you know, a lot of healthcare is still not fully digitized, there are some elements of healthcare which in significant number of hospitals are digitized. So, you know, it's quite rare for many of us in urban India to see a lab report that was not a printed output. Most hospitals are starting to provide discharge summaries, which are also kind of typed, while prescriptions are still probably in many cases handwritten. But the National Digital Health Mission starts to target things that are already digital and things that are already being given to the patient. You know, we're not looking at new data digitization as much as, you know, what is already digital and can we have a way or a standards way in which we can give it. So, for example, when I got my COVID test recently, end of the COVID test, I got a SMS. I was able to go to the website of the lab. I was able to punch in the code and I was able to see the PDF in a few seconds on my mobile device. Now, we are not saying that, you know, in fact, we are saying that we just need to build on or extend onto the same idea. What could it be if that lab was actually adding that report onto my longitudinal health record and making it part of my longitudinal history and allowed me so that, you know, because in a year from now, I'm sure I would have forgotten that password out of the PDF where I got it from. And also B, start sharing the data today, which is a PDF in a little more structured format that makes it useful for programs to have analytics and the ability to use it. So that's really what we're looking at. So we're looking at software being used by hospitals and labs today to make that shift so that they can start interacting or doing it in a way so that they start sharing the patient data digitally. And we also think that will enable a whole host of new tools. So not very far in the future, I visualize that you'll be able to go to a hospital. You'll be able to register by just scanning your health ID there. You will get a little request on your phone saying, you know, this hospital wants your consent to access your medical history. You're going to give that. And by the time you walk in and see the doctor is probably going to have a new set of tools that has looked at your history and now is, you know, enabling them to make better decisions for your care. And if the doctor actually provides any additional information, new diagnostic tests, prescriptions, they'll get added to your longitudinal record. So, you know, all of this is possible with the digital building blocks that has been announced by the NDHM. And it's also taken an approach where it has created something we call the sandbox. So, which is a place for all startups, all innovators. It's open to anybody with a registration in India. It could even be done by a student. It can also be done by organizations. They can apply, they can come in and they can actually integrate their solutions in the sandbox, test and validate that they're able to kind of do this. So while the National Digital Health Mission, I spoke about how it enables movement of personal health data with consent, there are purposes for which you can ask for the data. So, you know, if you're, and the second thing that it also enables is certain collection of aggregated data for policy purposes and the ability in the future to create anonymized data sets, which could be very useful for AI. Like we all know that in the current COVID scenario, if for x-rays, chest x-rays, you know, it was a great opportunity for AI to look at, you know, whether there is presence or absence of COVID in terms of analytics. But that, as we know, requires significant amount of data. So this new layer that is coming in provides for two things. One, as we hope to get market adoption and much more of the healthcare ecosystem starts to participate, it will make sure that A, you can move around health data of an individual in compliance, full compliance with the Personal Data Protection Bill with the privacy and security safeguards. So you can be sure that when you get your software to be compliant to this approach, you are pretty much, you know, in a place where you are sure that you are compliant with the laws that regards with security and privacy, and you can actually democratize or unlock the health data for many care contexts. And it's a bit, going to be probably a bit later as to how these larger anonymized data sets is going to be made available, but there are discussions in the government on how do we actually use, and many countries including Israel and others have done this, which is to see how can health data, anonymized health data and data sets from the population be made available to the startup ecosystem so that they can actually probably create world-class tools which will actually provide not only better healthcare and lower cost healthcare for India, but actually for the world. So in many ways, I think we are at the first step and very early steps. And of course, with all of these kind of things, there are big questions. There are questions on whether are we doing the right thing? Is this the right step? So the government is also proceeding with this in phases. So we are right now at a phase we call as the pilot phase, where we are actually having all of these ideas, these tools, and some of these solutions to be tested primarily in the UTs, and then looking at how that goes, then it'll actually scale up to the national level. It's also a phase when we are trying to understand what are the challenges that providers like hospitals or labs will face, or challenges that other parts of the ecosystem, whether it is policymakers, researchers, startups, integrators will actually face, so that we can actually take it forward. But that's the way we are. And so I'm personally very confident that India has started to take the first steps towards democratizing health data and trying to make sure that it is actually useful in the context of patients' care, but also create an architecture that's fairly unique to the country, actually fairly unique from how we have approached it. We have not copied the West. We have not copied either the US or the European GDPR approaches. We have actually taken a line which is slightly different from both in terms of the approach. So I think the next few months and years will play out on this. And I do think we are making the right steps in opening up for health data.
That is wonderful to know that we have got our own understanding and got our own Indian way of democratizing data, sir. And now going, Dr. Vishal, Dr. Shetty, any inputs from your end on this particular question on how democratizing data is going to be beneficial for India?
I do not have anything to add other than the fact that this is the only way we will be able to offer healthcare across the country to everyone. This is the only vehicle we have, digitizing healthcare. There is no other vehicle. This is the only hope we have.
Definitely. Thank you, sir. Dr. Vishal?
Prashant, just one quick point. You know, I was talking to one of the experts from Arizona University, and he actually told me a very interesting insight. They have something called REDCap, wherein actually it's a democratized database for researchers and innovators, wherein across universities and across institutions, there are some 20 lakh data out of patients database with CT scan, MRI follow-up, everything in under each disease specifics that innovators or researchers could access to in order to build their hypothesis, thesis, PhD or a product. I think that is the kind of ecosystem that our innovators would require to quickly come up with products, rather than get stuck with ethics committees or get stuck with scientific committees or hospital managements who do not understand the ecosystem of innovation.
Yeah. Definitely, sir. Rajesh, you have your inputs.
Yeah, I think Kiran made some very good points, and I would agree that in terms of, you know, IT systems, India is taking a lead role, especially in the global south, and we have a potential to be the leader in entire the Asia and probably Africa also, because the frameworks that we are developing are really state of the art. Number two, AI, if you look at, make a count of all the universities that have tie-ups with hospitals in India, probably the count will be about 200 odd. And what's happening is all of them want Indian data for training their AI machines. And if we can do this whole democratization of data and also secure the way we share data, we can actually monetize this data in a very big way. And we should act quickly on that. That's my 2 points.
Got it, noted. Thank you for the inputs. Now coming to Dr. Vishal, the question to you is, how do you, we are talking about the ecosystem, building up an ecosystem, and you know, ecosystem is very much essential right now. So what according to you is a perfect ecosystem or a good enough ecosystem to help these healthcare startups ensure that they reach the market faster and be successful?
Sure. Prashant, if you look at what a basic startup needs today, I think I could sum it up in 5 points. A startup needs funding, a startup needs IP support for intellectual property, they need regulatory guidance. Number four, they will need market intelligence. And five is market access. This is all five they need. Unfortunately, there have been so many proliferating incubators that have come up now, but they do not address these five. I feel a real incubator should dynamically address these five things. That's all they need. I mean, you can leave the startup to roam on the road. Don't give them the table, chair, AC room and computer. Give them these five: the funding, the IP, the regulatory, market access, market intelligence. And I'm sure they're going to change the game. I think that is what is fundamentally needed. And here, I think the one single behavioral change that India needs to do is to stop moving from the copycat attitude that let the West innovate, we will copy. Instead, if we can originally do it, because today the philosophy here is that let us let the West innovate it and then we will buy it at 3 times the price. But if our own people want to do it, there is no funding for research and innovation here. And I think that ecosystem has to happen at the level of medical colleges. And I'm sure you are the witness that Rajiv Gandhi University, when they did the innovation program, the Ideathon, we had in 5 days 1,600 applications, of which I think 27 were pure market related access. I mean, these were 27 ideas that I personally felt if I had the money, I would invested in them. The point is that the 27 are going to perish because there was no ideas. And I think you should brief Dr. Shetty about the entire presentation of it. I'm sure he's going to be so happy listening to it, that those 1,200 applications were all brilliant. We saw in the dissection table in first year students, people giving us such brilliant ideas with so much clarity, which I did not have when I was in first year MBBS. So I think the ecosystem is what needs to be created in terms of nurturing and kind of collaborating in this particular environment. And I would like to just sum it up by saying that this is the era of collaboration and not competition. Today you see Google is going to collaborate with Google is going to collaborate on data with JBL, and JBL will use their speaker for the Google's the home app. This is the collaborative ecosystem that is happening across the globe, that each and every person is collaborating in various, and even the competitors are collaborating, and that is the ecosystem that is being built up across. The one very interesting lesson I learned last 2 years back, we were at a panel discussion at the Harvard Business School where a person presented a very brilliant idea. This gentleman actually had, he ran a mobile service company, and he collaborated with an insurance company, a health insurance company. And they actually came up with a collaborative program in Africa, I guess, where if you increase your talk time, your insurance was automatically getting covered, your health insurance. And they both built a very cross-disruptive collaborative platform. And I think that is the kind of ecosystem we would need to build of cross collaboration across ecosystems. Thank you.
Definitely. Dr. Devesh Shetty, sir, your inputs?
Yeah, I'm okay. Thank you so much. Thank you, Prashant. Wonderful.
Okay. Rajesh and Kiran?
Yeah, well, Dr. Vishal has the experience of having built something and, you know, patenting it. I think one challenge a lot of our good innovators, especially in India, have is that sometimes they spend years together on building something, and then a big company comes and builds it within a matter of a few years. And essentially, there are no clear patenting support provided to startups. And I've seen some very difficult stories where a person spent like 5 years for building an AI tool, and somebody else just came from abroad and just took it over in a matter of months. And we need to think of how we can protect some of these innovators. I will leave it at that. Thank you.
Mr. Kiran?
Nothing more to add on this question.
Okay. Now we'll just take two question and answers. This one is how is the medical school curriculum evolving to prepare doctors in the world of tomorrow? Are they giving them the tools of digital, the AI, and also how are they allowing them to collaborate with the startups? Anyone want to take this question? Dr. Vishal?
I think I can answer.
Yes, sir.
See, the our medical curriculum is not up to date, but with the National Medical Commission, which is replaced the Medical Council of India, we expect dramatic transformation in the way medical education is delivered. Now, medical education is essentially an apprenticeship. You cannot teach medicine in the classroom or in the library. The only place where you can learn the art of caring for the patient is the bedside. But unfortunately, our curriculum is not designed for that, because they specifically mention this many hours of classroom teaching. Now, that has no meaning, because I remember I read about carcinoid syndrome, which is one of those syndromes. There are thousands of syndromes we need to mug as medical students. First MBBS, I learned about carcinoid syndrome. Second MBBS, I learned about it because they're all exam questions. Third year, fourth year exam, fifth year exam, final year exam. Then I did MS. First year, the MS, again, it's a standard question. And I appeared for all kinds of exams, remembering carcinoid syndrome. And in my whole life, I saw one carcinoid syndrome patient in England and a second carcinoid syndrome detected by somebody else in India. Now, is it really important for us to know so much in detail about carcinoid syndrome? Today, if I just open my phone and tell Google carcinoid syndrome, it will give me everything about it. So we need to change our way of training the young doctors. We have to learn to differentiate between knowledge and the skill. And if a doctor has no very little skill, lot of knowledge, he's of no use to the patient.
True, sir. That's very, very true. Most of the learning happens from the patient than from the books. That's what most of my medical professors were telling. Be by the bedside and learn the best. And that's what you're reverberating again. Thank you for that. And the next question is specifically to Kiran. When is the health ID going to be rolled out by the government?
So the health ID is actually already live, and you can actually go to healthid.ndhm.gov.in and check it out. But it's been launched right now only in select UTs where we are piloting it. And we are expecting a national rollout shortly, probably aligned with the vaccination program or other things that are coming up. For those interested in understanding what is happening on the NDHM building blocks, I suggest that you please go to sandbox.ndhm.gov.in, and there is also a very good discussion forum for developers where you can actually look at and what it takes to integrate with these various components and get that going.
Thank you, Kiran. On the closing comments, I want each and every panelist to just sum up the whole thing and give one or two key points as a takeaway. Sir Devi Sitisha, we'll start with you.
Yep. I think there has to be awareness created by NSR cell across the country that you are going to invite all the interesting proposals that will create an awareness. Then, of course, we should see how we can tie up with as many hospitals as possible, because these are the very important stakeholders for the success of any startup. And we should create one contact person in every large hospital who will be given all these various proposals, if they are particularly interested in something. Like, we have a list of things what we are interested in. Like, we have so many cardiac monitors and so many machines, and there is no way I can get the data from the machine. So if there is a startup which is going to work on this product and create an intermediary wherein I can get the data from the machine, I would love to support that startup. Like this, we have a whole lot of requests. So we can also ask the hospitals to give their requests, which you can post it in public forum for the startup, whoever is interested. And as I said, you know, I'm very, very keen for any robot company which can make a toy robot to carry blood sample inside the hospital. Yeah, like this, there are many, many things we can do. I think we should really, really look at a different way of approaching people with the knowledge and the customers who want all these products and getting them together.
Noted, sir. Thank you. And I hope that NH will be our key partner with the NSISL for the healthcare vertical and the healthcare ecosystem.
Certainly, certainly. It's our privilege.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Rajesh, closing comments from your side?
First of all, congratulations. It's a pleasure to see IIMs with some of the best brains cooperating with companies like Dr. Shetty's hospital, which is great for India. My only leaving thought is that when you're creating a health startup innovation hub, please don't get into another silo, because we always need cross-industry collaboration. For example, the biggest, when we talk to a minister in Ghana, his issue is, sir, we have all the equipment, but we don't have power. We have 1 hour of power every day. So we are collaborating with ISA, the International Solar Alliance, to see how we can power public health centers. So essentially, I think when you do this hub, you need to look broadly between industries and see how you can collaborate. And collaboration is a very, very key word. That's it from me. Thank you.
Thank you. That's exactly what we are trying to create. Break the silos and create a platform for everyone to cross-collaborate. Mr. Kiran, closing comments from your side?
Yeah. Actually, as a Bangalorean, yeah, wonderful to see, you know, I am Bangalore and especially this initiative. And I do know that there's a whole number of very active startups in Bangalore and many of them in digital health. So from my perspective, I think it's a fascinating time to look at what are the possibilities. While it's still early, I think the next couple of years will provide a significant number of new opportunities for a new class of companies that can actually build on to some of these starting blocks that we have on the National Digital Health Mission. And I'm so personally looking forward to seeing what comes out of the NRCSL in this space on anything on digital health. You know, do keep me posted, and any way that I can help in that process, will be very happy to contribute my time and efforts. Thank you.
Wonderful, sir. We are looking forward for giving you more options from the ecosystem. Thank you, Dr. Vishal. Your closing comments.
Thanks, Prashant. So again, I would like to congratulate you for all the efforts. Two quick points that I would like to close with is, I think the future of startups for the next decade would be more on non-domain expertise also. And I think this is one area which startups should focus on. Rather than getting knowledge obsessed, they should go for also non-domain expertise, because they give you a lot of fresh perspective. And this is something that I learned, that in the 20th century, ignorance is going to be power. In the earlier century, 21st century, knowledge was power. Now, ignorance will be power in this century. And this is most relevant, that we understand the power of ignorance, especially for innovators. Innovators do not need knowledge, because knowledge brings about status quo. This knowledge comes from existing people who have told you that this is the way it should be. If you need to question that, you need to get somebody who's absolutely ignorant and ask you a ridiculous question. And I think that's most important to know, that if the idea is not ridiculous, it's not innovative. So that's the point that I want to drive here. And again, reiterate the point that collaboration and not competition is the key here. the next 20 years, I'm saying the next two decades will be, you will see such rapid revolutions that are going to happen, and generation gaps are going to be defined by version gaps, version versus version two. You see last couple of months itself, you see the amount of new designations that have happened. I was reading some funny ones, Masters of Disasters, Digital Prophets, new titles that are coming in which you have never even heard of. The next generation will be that, and we need to make this conducive. Thank you.
Thank you all. Thank you all for all the panelists to give their esteemed time and valuable time for this discussion. I thank you all on behalf of NSRCell. I would like Aarti to come in for the closing comments.
Yeah. Thank you so much for that, Prashant. It was definitely a very engaging panel discussion. Some very interesting key takeaways for all of us. This has been a great way to kickstart our healthcare incubation program. We will be opening the application for incubation shortly on our website. To get further details, you could also connect to us through the email ID shared on screen. Once again, thanks to all panelists for taking time and sharing their insights with the startup. And thank you all for your participation.
Thank you, Aarti.
Thanks,
Prashant. Thank you all.
Thank you.